Welcome to Planet Lex, the podcast of Northwestern Pritzker School of Law, bringing it to you from Chicago, Illinois.
Hello, and welcome to Planet Lex. We're podcasting from the Northwestern Pritzker School of Law in Chicago. I'm your host, Vice Dean Jim Speta. Joining me today is Matthew Kugler, Assistant Professor of Law here at Northwestern. Before joining us at Northwestern, Matthew completed a PhD in psychology and social policy at Princeton. He received his JD down the street from us at the University of Chicago Law School, and he clerked for the famous Court of Appeals judge and famous legal scholar Richard Posner. Matthew's research addresses questions at the intersection of psychology and law, with a recent focus on the especially interesting issues of privacy law. Matthew, thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you, Jim.
I'm excited to talk about these issues, in part because they are so present, and in part because they intersect with my own work on internet law and policy. Your recent work has been on what I think of as a particularly current issue, regulation of the use of biometric information. But before we delve specifically into biometrics, let's talk a little more about the general landscape of privacy. What's at issue when we're talking about privacy? What sorts of information are people trying to protect?
A wide variety of things. At the core of privacy are usually issues of sex, family, and money. Having said that, people are also very concerned about privacy in domains that are less obvious than, say, naked pictures. So many people are concerned about location tracking, even if, by and large, they're not going anywhere all that interesting. They just feel it's very intrusive, they don't want to think about being monitored in that kind of way and people judging them based on where they're going. And when you get into the government side, the government is so omnipresent in our lives and makes so many decisions that concern our future that people are very concerned about the thought of being judged or classified based on any number of different factors. And that raises a whole set of liberty concerns that are absent in the private context.
One of the legal terms we sometimes hear in the privacy realm is this phrase, personally identifiable information. Is that what we're talking about when we talk about privacy?
We can mean a lot of different things. One thing we sometimes mean is that the information isn't anonymous. So if you take a big database of medical information, strip out anything that could ever link it back to you, suddenly a lot of the privacy concerns evaporated. You can now run analyses on that without endangering any particular person's privacy. So often, personally identifiable means that we have a name, an address, a social security number, anything that can come back and say, ah, yes, this was Jim, as opposed to this was a random person of a certain age living in the city of Chicago.
But as I think about how I go through life, I'm turning that information over all the time. My Visa card knows every time I have a cup of coffee and basically everything I buy. I use my Prime account for purchasing, 75% of the things we buy at the house. And now Prime knows everything I buy at the Whole Foods. How much of this personally identifiable information includes things people worry about on a day-to-day basis?
Well, it depends what you mean by worry. It could be that your Amazon Prime shopping list looks a lot like mine, and I wouldn't particularly mind if it got out that, yes, I buy a lot of cat food. What's the big deal there? On the other hand, there are people who buy things on Amazon that they do not want widely exposed. It could be that they're gay and don't want everyone in the world to know that, but yes, they're buying literature that is certainly consistent with that. It could be that they have hobbies that they don't want to have to justify to everyone in the world. And when people say, yes, Amazon knows everything about me, that's very different than my employer knows everything about me. It's very different even than my coworker or best friend knows everything about me. So it could very well be that Amazon, this company that doesn't actually care all that much about you as a person, knows far more about you than the people who pay your salary, or far more about you than your neighbor does, even though in the traditional world, these would be the people who would know you best.
Sometimes you hear people say, and I take it from what you've been saying that you just don't agree with this, but sometimes you do hear people say, I'm not doing anything wrong, so why should I worry about privacy?
Yeah, I would disagree with that, because when you think about what people want to do in their lives, it could be that they want to go home and read really trashy, really badly written romance novels. I know people who do that. They get a lot of joy from it.
You're sitting across the table from someone who did that at one point in his life.
Yes, and you're willing to admit that, and you have a wonderful collection of Legos in your office that I greatly admire, and I hope that that isn't something you considered private. But as we think about this, do we want to have to justify to everyone we meet our decision to read trashy romance novels? I read a lot of science fiction and fantasy. Some people consider that lowbrow. And I'm comfortable being open about that because I have a relatively secure job and I don't have to worry about whether a random law firm partner is going to be impressed. But if you're lower in the totem pole, you're entry level in an industry where people are very judgmental, you may not want to have to say, oh yes, Titan of finance, this is what I do with my free time. I hope you don't think this isn't impressive. So even if there's nothing embarrassing, nothing illegal, it's very hard to buy illegal things on Amazon, it still doesn't mean you want it to be public.
I want to talk a little bit now about, though, the reality that we're in, because I think I agree with you that privacy is still something we think about and still something we care about. But from my own research on the internet and from the physical side of how the internet ecosystem works, a lot of what's paying for the internet is advertising. And what we know from what advertisers do on the internet, whether the advertisers are sort of special purpose platforms like Facebook or advertisers that are engaged with a data broker who follows me around the internet, a lot of what I do out there in the real world is already being aggregated and portfolios are being built about me. I found this famous quote that I remember from when I got first involved in the telecom industry about 20 years ago, Scott McNeely, who was the CEO of Sun Microsystems, a company that used to be very important in the internet but isn't with us any longer, said, "Privacy is dead and people should just get over it." Is privacy dead today?
I would say not. And people certainly aren't getting over it. So even if they should, they're not going there. See, every time Mark Zuckerberg opens his mouth and the world goes insane. But as I think about privacy being dead, I really think privacy of what against whom? Is my social security number private? Yes, it is. It was issued to me by the government, so they know it. It's on file with several dozen different organizations at this point, but I would still consider it private. I wouldn't tell it to a random person on the street, and a random person on the street can't easily find it out. So when I think about all the things that big tech knows about me, I think that, yes, big tech knows about me, but for them, I'm a number in a database, and they're not going to randomly start exposing it to people. It's not going to end up in the New York Times just because Google knows it. And when I think about the context people care about, this idea of personal relationships, this idea of employment, then those people don't have ready access to that. And the thing that usually scares people about big tech is the thought that somehow that information might get out. So the idea of Facebook sending me targeted ads is much less scary than Facebook selling my profile. And it's usually the thought that Facebook might somehow sell my profile that would really get people up in arms, but the thought that they'll send me a targeted ad is a lower level of intrusion.
I like that. That's great. I particularly like what you said when you said that a core of the issue is of what and against whom. So let me ask you one last general question about privacy, and then I want to get into your very cool research, which is the against whom part, right? When it comes to personally identifiable information and privacy in general, we can be talking, as you and I mostly have been, about the information that private companies, companies that we interact with are accumulating about us. But there's also a governmental aspect to a lot of this information as well. What are some of the salient differences about how we should think of these issues if they involve governments or private companies?
So a historical note that might be more familiar to you than me, because I'm looking back way before I was in this field, but there used to be this thought that only the government would have this massive database of information about you. And there are these delightful reports from the 70s about this fear of government databases. And now when we think about databases, it's Google, it's Facebook, it's Amazon, all these private actors with all this information. So I think we've seen over the last 20 years a strong qualitative shift from the government having all the information to actually a number of different private actors also having all the information. Having said that, the thing that is true of the government and not true of any corporation is that the government can send you to jail. And you can talk about this in a Fourth Amendment context of finding drug dealers, and that's scary in its own way, but you shouldn't always trust that the government will be a good law-abiding institution that is really just trying to attack criminals. And we have seen cases overseas where the growth of a surveillance state starts leading to human rights abuses. So we have a multifactored conversation there because private capacity has caught up to government capacity and information aggregation, at least in a lot of respects. On the other hand, there's a whole set of liberty interests that come into play when the government is involved that are simply absent for private actors.
Great. And I think we'll come back to the question of government in just a minute. But let's turn specifically to the issue of biometric information, where, as I said, I think you've done some really interesting research recently. Let's start basically. What is biometric information and how does it relate to this question of private information?
So biometric information can mean a lot of things, and some jurisdictions have specific laws on this that define biometric information in very particular ways. Normally, when people say biometric information, they mean things like your fingerprints, your voice print, scans of facial geometry, which are the raw information used for facial recognition, iris scanning technology, things like that.
So I want to talk about face scanning. It's not a picture of me, but it's something that represents a picture of me?
Yes, that's mostly what it is. The idea here is that any picture of you is from a single angle, only captures so much information. A really good scan of facial geometry is somewhat three-dimensional, and it allows them to create a mathematical representation of your face that they can later use to recognize your face when it comes again. Often, if you just started with the scan of facial geometry, what they actually record for facial recognition, what they actually record for fingerprint, they wouldn't necessarily be able to reconstruct your fingerprint. So if you just kind of went deep inside your iPhone and said, what is my fingerprint? It might not know in the sense that looking at your finger would tell you.
Interesting. How do companies or governments, how is biometric information acquired? What is it used for?
So how it's acquired, there are basically two classes of ways of doing that. One way is to say, please step over here and look at this camera, turn your face a little this way, turn your face a little that way, or put your fingers on this scan, or please say exactly this phrase, which is what Vanguard always has me say. So that is one way of getting biometric information. The other way of getting biometric information is to say, we have found the following public pictures of this person. From them, we're going to try to deduce a scan of facial geometry. Or we found a recording of you doing a podcast, or we bumped into you on the street and you said a few words. We're going to try to get a scan of your voice print from that. And both of these methods are being widely used. As for what you can do with them, the easiest thing in the world to do is to say, hey, you gave us your fingerprints on this occasion. Now we want to go have you check in at the gym, at work, punch a time clock, whatever. Please scan your fingerprint again. We'll make sure you match.
Ah.
It's a way to kind of cut down on fraud with like, okay, you check in at work for me, I'll be half an hour late today. Or, oh, I'm a member at this gym, you go in my place today, save yourself a guest pass, something like that. So that's one possible set of uses. The other possible set of uses, which is in some sense a lot scarier, is this idea of we have a scan of your face, we're now going to go looking for your face. And you could do this with Facebook and photo tagging. So a new picture is uploaded and Facebook basically says, this looks like it's Jim Speta. Is this Jim Speta? Or you walk into a store and the security camera says, ah, this looks like Jim Speta. Do we want Jim Speta in this store? Or are we tracking what Jim Speta is shopping for in this store?
Or maybe we're going to give Jim Speta an especially good deal on something we think he might be interested in.
Yeah, we might send Jim Speta a text message saying, I see that you've been looking at these washing machines every time you come in. By the way, it's 10% off if you buy it today. That is a perfectly sensible use for this technology. And maybe that is to your advantage because you're thinking of buying a washing machine and this pushes you over the edge. That's good for everyone concerned. On the other hand, it does mean that if you walk into the store, they are tracking what you're looking at. So the classic example from Target was this idea of sending potential mothers baby catalogs based on their shopping behavior. They could tell that this person's probably in the second trimester. And they got into a lot of trouble with that, where a teenage girl's father found out that the girl was pregnant from Target rather than from the teenager.
I see. I take it from what you said about Facebook and Target that there are examples of this being used out there in industry already. Do you have a sense of how widespread the use cases are?
So of this kind of use, where they're trying to track consumer interest, track you in physical locations, it is really hard to get that information. I've been looking for it. Target, I have no particular reason to believe, has been using it. Lowe's for a while said they used facial recognition as a security feature in their stores. So they had a list of known shoplifters, people who'd been caught before, and they were looking to make sure these people were respecting their lifetime bans. So they used facial recognition to look for their faces. They used to say, we use it for this purpose and we don't do anything else with it. We certainly don't track customer interest. Then they changed their privacy policy to say neither of those things. And it's like, well, is it that you stopped using it for security or that you stopped wanting to guarantee that you wouldn't use it for anything else? They didn't return my email on that question.
They probably sent it along to their lawyers who said, don't answer it. But what about scanning of pictures that show up on Facebook or in my Google Photos or in Flickr or other sorts of photo services? Is facial recognition happening in those types of applications? Most of us have Facebook accounts, after all.
Yes, it is. And this is why Facebook has been sued. This is why Shutterfly has been sued. There's utility in saying you have uploaded 1,000 pictures over the last couple of years, and now you're making the photo album for grandma. Which pictures have grandma in them? That is the good use of this. There's also the good use of, okay, you've uploaded a new picture, and we've noticed that here are the 20 people you tend to tag, and of those 20 people, this really looks like Sarah and not Shelby or something like that. So there is customer value in that. On the other hand, what it means is that Facebook has a reservoir of facial recognition data, second only maybe to the driver's license database.
Interesting. You mentioned earlier that some regulation has entered into this area, and I think it's mostly at the state level. What's the current landscape of regulation of use of biometric information?
So in Illinois, if a company collects your biometric information, they need to get your written consent to do that, and they're not allowed to sell or share it.
Are we the only state that has a law like that?
So Texas and Washington also have laws on the protection of biometric information. The key thing is that only in Illinois can private citizens sue over the violation. That means that in Illinois, this law is being vigorously enforced, arguably overly enforced, whereas in the other two states, it is largely not being enforced. Now, California has a privacy law that's coming online in 2020 that provides some protection. Florida and Massachusetts are currently actively considering biometric privacy bills. I'm sure a number of other states are as well. But at the moment, this is an Illinois-centric conversation, in part because of a law that was somewhat randomly passed in 2008 and then discovered years later as a good vehicle for bringing these claims.
And there's been some litigation in Illinois, some pretty significant litigation, that has recently gone to the Illinois Supreme Court. What was the question that the Illinois Supreme Court had to decide about lawsuits involving biometric information?
So when you think about how these lawsuits would work, you'd have a company collecting your biometric information. Now, if it's an employer that says, okay, we know some of our employees are checking in their friends, they say, let's switch to thumbprints. Let's get rid of that concern. So they would switch to thumbprints, and now they have 400 employees checking in every day with their thumbprint. Thing is, under this statute, they had to get written consent for that. Most employers didn't seem to know that. So you have everyone and their mother being sued for this notice and consent violation. And the statute says aggrieved parties. That's a term in quotes, aggrieved parties.
Aggrieved parties can sue.
Can sue. So are you aggrieved if the only thing that's wrong is that you weren't given a consent form that you obviously would have signed? So no data breach concern, no sharing concern, just you weren't given the written information. So the case that came to the Illinois Supreme Court was actually against Six Flags. Their season ticket holders were doing fingerprints because they wanted to protect against exactly the same kind of fraud the employers did. And the question is it a harm that this person was not given the appropriate consent form? And the Illinois Supreme Court said, actually, yes. We think the Illinois legislature meant it when they gave people these extensive rights. We think there's value in forcing this kind of specific disclosure. So, yes, this is what the legislature meant to do. You are allowed to sue for just a failure of notice and consent. You don't need to show this kind of additional harm.
That's interesting. That makes it sound like the law gives really vigorous protection in this space.
Yes. And when we look at this law, it was passed relatively quickly. It is being used more broadly than I suspect could ever have been anticipated. But in a way, all they're trying to do is to force the companies to take the technology seriously. Because any employer who wants to do fingerprint check-in, you really just have to write your consent forms appropriately. And employees sign a lot of consent forms. Like you usually sign a computer use understanding agreement when you come to work. Okay, now just sign a biometric use agreement saying, yes, I understand my fingerprints will be taken for check-in purposes. And I understand that this information will be retained for the following number of years and used for this purpose. And suddenly there's no lawsuit. It's just that companies didn't know to do that. The other kind of lawsuit, though, is against Facebook, where Facebook has this giant catalog of information. It's incredibly powerful. They could do a lot with it. And this law would say, well, here are some things you just can't do, like sell it. And here are some things where if you want to do them, you have to tell everyone you're doing it, which is scary.
Interesting. So the court's decision, and in fact, the way you've described the statute itself, sort of takes the implicit position that biometric information is somehow different than other kinds of information and is something that people probably do care about in a particular way, which brings me to the study that you've done. And I take it that that question about what do people care about when it comes to their biometric information is the question that you sought to study. So tell us a little bit about what you did.
So it really does come down to that. Is biometric information special, or is it basically an ID card that you can't lose? Because from a convenience standpoint, the idea of checking in with your thumbprint is so much easier than having to remember yet another CVS keychain or something like that. So is it just that? I did a study saying, imagine you're checking in at work or checking in at a coffee shop loyalty program or checking in at a gym, and it works by ID card. You scan when you show up. Here are the things they track about your ID card scan. How comfortable are you with that? And then a separate group of people were told, everything is the same, except I'm not telling you it's ID card, I'm telling you it's a thumbprint. Or everything's the same, except it's facial recognition. How do you feel as we go from ID card to these other things, with separate groups of people getting each scenario? And what I found is that people were meaningfully less comfortable if it was a thumbprint rather than an ID card.
Tell me a little bit about how you asked people these questions. I'm not a researcher in these in this field. So how did you pose these scenarios to people, and how did they give you their feedback?
So it was an online study to a representative sample of people. And the idea was, I'm going to give you a vignette. I'm going to tell you that you're arriving at work, and here are the steps you're going through. And I'm going to try to give it to you in a matter-of-fact sort of way. There's nothing more natural in the world than showing up and scanning your thumb and continuing on through the doors. So to try to make it very bland. I didn't want people to get worked up about biometrics. I wanted it to be part of the experience. So after I give them this scenario, I say, how comfortable are you with how you checked in at work today? And on a separate page, having gotten their comfort ratings on that, I then said, well, you checked in using a thumbprint. Would you have preferred to check in using an ID card? And for the coffee shop case, I really liked the question I was able to ask here because I said, imagine you get every 10th coffee free for being in this customer loyalty program. Do you want to be in it? And if people were using an ID card, about 80% said, yes, I would want to be in this customer loyalty program. Every 10th coffee free is worth doing this. And if it worked by biometrics, about 50% said, every 10th coffee free is worth it for this program. So we dropped a fairly shocking amount just by switching from ID card to thumbprint or facial recognition.
So what do you think that means, or what implications do you think that has for the question of whether the Illinois law is a good law or whether we ought to have more regulation in this space?
So on the specific question of whether it's a harm to collect biometric information, I think this is telling us that a meaningful number of people would say it's a harm, that people do get more uncomfortable just because biometrics have been used. Now, whether the Illinois law is a good law is a much bigger question, because I did do a second study in that paper where I said, here are a large number of possible uses of biometric information. So abandoning the story scenario and saying, here as a two or one sentence thing is a possible way you can use biometrics. So using facial recognition to look for known shoplifters, for instance, and said, well, which of these make you uncomfortable? And I found a lot of heterogeneity. Some of these were things people were very comfortable with, and some of these were things people were very uncomfortable with. Now, the Illinois law would treat all of them the same. And as a first pass, maybe just saying value biometric privacy is a good thing for a state legislature to do. What I was staring at as I looked at this data was, well, using this to just do basic security, like having one of those smart doorbells that identifies who comes up to your door, or just checking in at work and you know the information is not being used for anything else, this is actually the least threatening case. The most threatening case is when you start using facial recognition to track people who wander through a neighborhood, or to track customer interest in a store, or to do some of these big data things that we might be afraid that a Facebook or Google would do. So it's possible that what you really want is a regulatory regime that differentiates between these two kinds of uses.
And is that the kind of response that you received to the second group of questions about different uses of the data? Were people's discomfort tracking that sort of distinction between big data and small data, for lack of a better term?
It wasn't quite framed as big data versus small data, but as you were looking at the uses, it seemed like those categories were suggesting themselves. So you have a supermajority of people who are comfortable using a fingerprint to unlock their phone and their phone's apps. That seemed to not be a problem. On the other hand, you had a supermajority of people saying, yes, I'd be very concerned with facial recognition being used to serve me targeted advertising around a store, as you were starting off. That was 74% saying that they were more uncomfortable than comfortable.
Interesting. Interesting. One of the things that strikes me as interesting as you describe the regulation, and this comes up in the internet realm that I work in from time to time, is that this regulation is happening at the state level, right? And most of us, when we use the internet, when we use Facebook, when we use other things, we don't think about where is Facebook or where is Google. I mean, we have a sense that it's out there somewhere in California, probably. Why do you think the regulation is happening at the state level as opposed to the federal level in the United States? And does it make sense for it to be at the state level or the federal level? I know you didn't study that question, but do you have a sense of that?
So there are a couple of different answers. On the case of biometric privacy in particular, Illinois has this law because the tech industry did not know it was being passed. I went back and I looked at the legislative debates, and you have no Facebook, you have no Google, you have no Microsoft. They just didn't show up. At the federal level, they would have noticed. So every once in a while, something sneaks through at the state level because not everyone's paying attention. That is far less true today than it was in 2008. They've been burned. They know to go looking. So you see more action in that sense. Congress has been particularly slow to act these last couple of years for a variety of reasons, and we've seen that across domain. Having said that, it is rather painful to see this at the state level. And every time I see a law firm commentary on these laws, one of the things they lead with is this is a compliance nightmare. Because you could start having every state pass their own biometric privacy law, and those laws would be different and have different requirements or possibly even contradictory requirements. And suddenly it gets very hard for companies to comply. Whereas if you had a nice uniform federal law, at least everyone would know what the rules were. As it is, Illinois is setting biometric privacy for the entire country in some sense, because companies have to deal with the fact that there are millions of users in Illinois, and California, when it goes online with its law, is going to do the same thing. So we'd much rather have a nice federal law that sets out clear rules that have been fully informed. Instead, that's just really hard to make happen at a political economy sort of level.
Let me ask you to look in your crystal ball in two regards. First, what do you think might happen in the regulation? Or you can answer the other question, or hopefully both of them. What things would we still like to know about the use of biometric information that we don't know, that you and others haven't had a chance to study yet?
So what I've been noticing about the use of biometrics internationally is that China has been leading the way. And when you think about the kind of government China has and the kinds of things they're trying to do and what they're trying to surveil and monitor, that is deeply concerning. And they've been exporting that. So I was chatting with a student earlier this week, and Brazil during Carnival was using facial recognition to scan the crowd looking for people they were trying to arrest. And they were relatively successful at that. When we think about that kind of use, it's like, well, are we going to import that technology next? Probably not from that particular Chinese company, given that we have recently arrested one of their executives, and I don't see a friendly relationship there. But is that something the U.S. is going to also get on board with, or are we going to resist that? Is this the kind of thing where Facebook is going to start trying to market its facial recognition database to people? Because if you have cameras in your public transit system, you would love to be able to scan the people on that public transit system and say, hey, this is that person over there that we were looking for. Or here is a potential suspect. We now know they were on the other side of town that day. Like, that's very useful information and something we could easily want to do going forward. But we don't know if that's where we're going. Because that is hard. You have to have the cameras, you have to link the cameras, you have to build the database, and each and every one of these steps is prone to inefficiency. So when we start doing that, I imagine we're going to start seeing regulation, because then it will be here and it will be real. But I think we need some impetus to really get a federal law rolling. And it could be that when California's privacy law goes online, suddenly Facebook, Google, and Microsoft just go to the federal government and say, please, please give us a uniform federal law. We're going insane. Maybe that will do it.
California itself is the sixth or seventh biggest economy in the world, so it will cause the federal government and lots of other countries to pay attention to what's happening in this particular space in a way that they never had before.
Yes, and I mean, Europe's privacy law, I think, in part helped inspire California's privacy law and has really kicked everyone into high gear in exactly that way. And it's just a question of what it really takes to overcome congressional dysfunction. A lot of people were very excited in the run-up to 2016, saying an FTC under Hillary Clinton might really protect a lot of personal privacy. We'd see some action there. The FCC, same thing. Instead, Donald Trump was elected, and these agencies have taken a very different regulatory approach. So I don't think we can really divorce the question of privacy's future from the question of the country's future. And certain kinds of leadership will result in certain kinds of policies.
Well, on that note, and those important questions, which I actually don't think are all that far in the future, because when I take the subway, I see the cameras are already there. We'll have to promise to have you back in just a very short period of time and ask these questions again.
Thank you, Jim.
Thanks for coming, Matthew. That's our show for today. Thank you all for joining me. If you like what you heard, please subscribe and rate us on Apple Podcasts. I'm Jim Speta, signing off from the Northwestern Pritzker School of Law.
If you'd like more information about today's show, please visit law.northwestern.edu/planetlex or legaltalknetwork.com. Subscribe via iTunes and RSS. Find both Northwestern Pritzker School of Law and Legal Talk Network on Twitter, Facebook, and LinkedIn. Or download the free app from Legal Talk Network in Google Play and iTunes. The views expressed by the participants of this program are their own and do not represent the views of, nor are they endorsed by, Northwestern University, Legal Talk Network, or their respective officers, directors, employees, agents, representatives, shareholders, and subsidiaries. None of the content should be considered legal advice. As always, consult a lawyer.